Hi, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of ATP, Ask the Pastor. I am Pastor Joshua Sullivan here at Holy Cross Lutheran Church in Kerrville, Texas. Thanks for joining me. Today's question is, hello, Pastor. For years, I've been reading from the New King James Version of the Bible, as well as the King James Version. Just recently, in May of 2014, a new Textus Receptus Bible has come out. It is called the MEV, the Modern English Version. This is a retranslation from the KJV, the King James Version. Look at it sometime at BibleGateway.com or ModernEnglishVersion.com. This New English Bible also uses the Masoretic text for the OT, just as the New King James and KJV do. I tried reading this New English translation, and I still prefer the New King James Version over the Modern English Version, but I'd like to get your opinion on it as well. You can find it here and here and here, lists some websites. Hope to hear from you soon. Thanks. Yeah, sure, we can look at this. In fact, I had not heard of this. I know of a couple Bible translations that are in the works here and there, but I had not heard of this one yet. So thanks for cueing me into this one. Now, whenever we consider a Bible translation, there's always a couple questions we want to ask. The first question is always, what's the Greek text behind the New Testament then? As I've said in other videos, I prefer the majority text, or as you call it there, another name for it, the Textus Receptus, the received text, simply because, A, it's been used for the longest time in the church throughout its history, and then, two, I don't like the eclectic method of the modern textual critics who end up with a Franken text, a patchwork New Testament that doesn't actually exist anywhere. Modern textual criticism isn't really a science. It's purely subjective. And really, that's what you get with the Greek text behind most of the modern, at least the popular modern translations. So you mentioned, and so does the website here, that the MEV uses the Textus Receptus, the majority text. So it warrants some consideration on my part. Now, second, this is just as important as the first question, is what's the translation philosophy behind any translation? There are two. One is formal equivalency, the other is dynamic equivalency. Formal equivalency is more of a word-for-word translation from the original into the target language. Now, no translation can be strictly 100% word-for-word. If it was, it would be unreadable in a lot of cases, because Greek is not English. They have different grammar, they have different syntax, etc. then. The point of formal equivalency of this word-for-word translation is to get the words of God as closely as we can in our language as they were in the original autographs, or in the original languages then. And so, now dynamic equivalency, on the other hand, is more of a thought-for-thought. And so instead of trying to get a word-for-word, you're trying to say, well, what's the sense of this passage, and how do I get that sense into the target language, English in our case then? The reason I don't like dynamic equivalency is, A, I think it does a little bit of violence to the Word of God. These are the very words of God, and so we should be doing our best to translate them as closely to the original as we can. But also, B, then, the reason I don't like dynamic equivalency is because it ultimately puts another layer between you and the text. And that's, there's already the idea, the layer of translation, but with a thought-for-thought translation methodology, then it adds this layer of you're asking for the translator to really double down on being an interpreter as well. You know, a lot of the popular modern translations use dynamic equivalency, like the NIV, and we see the stuff that works in the NIV, how that mucks a couple things up, but we see that in its extreme in the paraphrases, like the Message, or as we call it, the Massage, because it doesn't even resemble God's Word anymore. So I really don't care for dynamic equivalency at all, because it's inviting the translator to be even more of an interpreter than he is just by nature of translating the text into his mother tongue. Now, reading through what you wrote about the MEV, and also then the stuff on the website, it chooses the formal equivalency methodology. So again, this warrants some consideration. Also, looking through a few key passages here and there on Bible Gateway, I didn't see any of the gender-neutral tomfoolery that's going around, especially with the new NIV and things like that. So, all in all, there's got a lot of promise here. Now, the big thing is that I appreciated about their website was the fact that they had comparisons between the Modern English Version and other versions, other modern versions, including the KJV and the New King James. Now, for the most part, the selections showed that they were just simply going back to the wording of the KJV in a lot of cases, and that's fine. There were a couple instances, though, in which words, translations were used, they were updated. For instance, one that I appreciated was in Philippians 4, verse 12. In Philippians 4:12, KJV and New King James translated as, "I know both how to be abased and I know how to abound." Now, nobody uses the word abase anymore. And I do like it because it goes with, there's an assonance between "I know how to be abased" and "I know how to abound." You've got the assonance of the two A sounds there, and so it works well for memorization. But nobody talks like that anymore. So the MEV translates that as, "I know both how to face humble circumstances and how to have abundance." People understand what it means to have humble circumstances, at least in theory. And so I like that update. That makes sense. Now, some of the updates I don't care for. The MEV has Peter in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, writing, "to the refugees scattered across the Roman Empire," whereas KJV has "strangers" and NKJV has "pilgrims." NIV has "exiles" for some reason. Yeah. No, who knows? Refugees is an update for the MEV from "pilgrims" or "strangers." And I don't care for it because, one, refugees are in the news an awful lot, but I think these days we often think of a refugee as someone who is a political refugee, someone who's fleeing their homeland to go to a foreign land to escape persecution and this sort of thing. And that's not the sense of the word here. That's why I like "pilgrim" or "stranger," because Christians are not like modern refugees who are fleeing their homeland because of war and violence, but rather we are pilgrims and strangers traveling back towards the promised homeland of everlasting life. And so I think I understand why they made that. I don't care for it. Another one that I really don't care for is their first example in Genesis 4:1. Adam had relations with his wife, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain and said, "I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord." Now, traditionally, Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived. That led to conception. Now, "had relations" is a euphemism, of course, just like "knew," to know is. But it makes the point that Adam and Eve had sex, because that's how you make babies. But "had relations" is much more sterile, in my opinion. No pun intended. And I say that because "had relations" empties that act of all of its marital intimacy, which I think is conveyed better by "Adam knew his wife, and she conceived them." That's my first gripe with it. Also, the phrase at the end, when Eve says, "I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord," is troublesome because "with the help of" actually isn't in the Hebrew text, which is fine. You can fill that in. But I also think it obscures the hope that Eve had that Cain would be a man of God or man from God to succeed where her husband and she had failed in the Garden of Eden then. So I think the MEV translation of Genesis 1:4 is a misfire. But still, it's better than the NIV's translation. "Adam made love to his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain, and she said, 'With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man.'" So again, you know, I like sticking with the biblical, metaphors, the biblical idiom of, you know, "Adam knew his wife." I think that also has a payout then in the prophets, as far as the intimate knowledge that the Lord has when he knows his people. That's a different Bible study, we say. Ultimately, to get a much better feel for this, I'd have to take it with a hard copy for a year and just read through it for my daily devotions. That'd be the best way to really get to know any new translation that you're looking at. And I'm open to doing something like that, but the book budget is maxed out at the moment. Very rarely does a translation come out that I'm actually interested in. The MEV could be interesting, though. Like you, I don't think it will replace the New King James. We're still going to use the NKJV for divine service here at Holy Cross, for Bible studies, for pastoral care at hospital calls, home calls, these sorts of things then. But I have to say, you know, for all of this, based on my limited interaction with the Modern English Version, it ain't bad, and it's leaps and bounds ahead of NIV and other popular translations. So I didn't know this one existed. Thanks for pointing it out to me. If you got a question about Bible translations or any question that's on your mind, shoot me an email, ATPHolyCross, that's all one word, ATPHolyCross@gmail.com. We'll put your question in the queue, and we'll get to it as soon as we're able. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.